Hey there, and welcome to another episode of Seenu. Today, we're going to be working on a variety of things that I yet have to decide, because this is, you know, me before recording the time-lapse. But before we get into the building part of this episode, I just wanted to take a moment to show you some of the things that we've been working on in the previous live stream, and some of the things I've been doing off-camera between the live stream and today. By the way, if you don't know what I'm talking about, last weekend, since there wasn't a video because I really didn't have time, I decided to just do the first Seenu live stream. So in case you haven't seen it and you don't want to get any spoilers, I highly encourage you to go check out the link in the description. You can watch, you know, almost three hours of footage there, and then come back to this episode and watch it. But we've been basically working on this little neighborhood right here. And we specifically focused on adding details to this area. So the whole point of that was to get some sort of like base design aesthetic, and then later replicate it through, you know, the rest of the neighborhood, which is kind of what I did off camera, among a few other things. But let me just show you what this looks like. First of all, we have a bus line now that connects this little neighborhood with the cargo harbor over there, but we'll get to that in a moment as well. Just wanted to point it out because I did design this like really simple yet pretty bus stop over here, and I think there's a bus coming right in. Yeah, these are the buses, by the way. These like vans are basically transporting people from point A to point B, and also we have this like tiny bus model too. They're all white, like pretty simple, pretty plain. And I absolutely love it. Also changed some of the police cars. We can follow this guy right here. Because, we had the default vanilla, you know, American-style police cars. It didn't look great, so just decided to change that. As well as the ambulances, which I don't see anything right now. But it's like a Japanese model, so it definitely fits this whole area much, much better. We actually have two different police models. In any case, let me just show you some of the actual fine-tuning detail that I've been doing over here. So this is our police station, and there's multiple things going on here. First of all, we have the dirt roads that, these are like the regular dirt roads, but let me just show you how they look when you just plop them. You'll notice that these are significantly darker than this one's. And what I'm doing here, it's basically using the surface painter to get rid of all of the textures. And you can still see sort of the grooves on the road, you know, from the traffic passing by, which is a texture that I actually kind of liked. And then what I did on top of it is just, I put, you know, a whole bunch of mud decals and dirt decals and, you know, just a huge combination of different decals. And we're achieving this look right here. Let me zoom in again. There we go. Which, it looks freaking fantastic. It looks really, really rural. And that totally fit the theme that I was aiming for in this little neighborhood. And also, I mean, we have a combination of different plants and trees and grass and even seaweeds we have growing on or going on around this area, and it looks very, very jungly, which is also the aesthetic that I was looking for. These, by the way, these patches of broken rocks, these are actually vanilla. I just discovered them the other day. If you go, if you search destroyed, actually, yeah, I don't have to type the whole thing. There's multiple ones of them. You can even get like vehicles that are destroyed that look really, really nice. I need to use these more often. I'm sure they're part of the natural disasters DLC, even though it's turned off right now. So these will be in your base game too, as long as you have updated to the latest version. But you don't really need to buy the DLC, I guess that's what I'm trying to say. So I use these rocks to sort of like, you know, extend this concrete patch beyond the police station and towards the road. And yeah, they do look pretty amazing. Another thing that I did in multiple areas of this neighborhood, let me see if I can find one. So for example, right here, you'll notice that these roads don't have the you know, the grooves that I was mentioning a second ago from the dirt roads. The reason for that is that I'm actually using a combination of, and we're gonna go over here so I can show you, using a combination of concrete roads and dirt roads at the same time. And if you use Surface Painter on this one, let me crease the brush, you'll notice that this ones do have the grooves and this ones do not. And the whole point of that is to sort of have the appearance of more traffic driving on these roads than on this one. So here's a good example. You have this one's with the road markings, I guess, or not the road markings, but the grooves of the traffic passing by, whereas this one, it's, you know, much more simple and doesn't have that much damage, I guess. So it's kind of an interesting combination, and it gives you a little bit of a variety in your road networks. Real quick, going back to the police station for a moment, I wanted to point out something that's actually kind of awesome. So these bollards that you see here were specifically created for this Seenu map because, well, these are the bollards that you actually see in the Addu Atoll, which is, where this city is based on. And they were created by the user named That Evan, and I've been using it in multiple places. For example, here on this, four-way intersection, 5-way intersection. Yes, 5-way. Obviously I'm pairing them with these amazing decals that Ronick's been putting out. He's putting out one decal a day, by the way, for the whole month. So, and there's some really amazing ones that I'll show you in just a moment. You definitely need to check out his Steam Workshop profile. And talking about the bollards again, I also created this like illegal dumping area with a whole bunch of trash, and I thought it was like a nice place to sort of surround it with the bollards so that cars don't drive over all of this mess. But thank you, Evan, for your submission. I'm gonna include the link in the description to that specific asset in case you want to try it in your own cities. One more thing that I wanted to talk about is sort of the creation process of this neighborhood. You see, I made a few mistakes when I was putting this together, and hopefully this will help us be more efficient in the future creating similar types of neighborhoods, and maybe you can learn a thing or two that you maybe didn't know. So if you watch the live stream, you'll notice that I start by laying down the roads. In this case, they were all dirt roads, and then I put down the houses using Rico, which is, you know, pretty straightforward. And then that's when one of the biggest mistakes I made happened. I mean, I'm making it sound like it was a huge deal, but thing is, I put down the trees next to the houses, which was fine. The problem is that I knew already that I wanted to have fences around some of these lots, and having the trees in place makes it really hard to know what the boundaries of things are. Because you definitely don't want the fences to be on the roads, but trying to get them aligned in between the trees is really, really tricky. So I would recommend do the trees at the very last. In fact, I would even recommend to lay down asphalt roads first, not even dirt roads, because you end up with things like this. For example, in this case, I wanted maybe this fence to be closer to the road and have enough of a gap for the sidewalks. However, since we have this dirt road with no textures, you really can't tell where cars are gonna spawn or park. And it makes it really, really tricky to align all these fences. So if I were to start a neighborhood like this again, and trust me, we will do multiple neighborhoods like this. In fact, most of the city will look like this. I will definitely start with, for example, these types of roads where you can clearly see the edges of things. In fact, if you look at these fences, they're much more better aligned to everything else. And that's because you can clearly see where the sidewalk ends, where the curve ends, where cars will be parked, what the lanes are, and everything else. The dirt road has the same width and all the same properties. So once you're done putting all your fences, you can just simply, upgrade or downgrade the paved roads to dirt roads, and then you're pretty much done. So this whole area looks good, but it took me way longer than it would have otherwise taken if I didn't have the trees or, a proper road layout. Last but not least, the docks. There's so much going on here, and in fact, I'm actually late on getting this video out because of some work that I've been doing in preparation for, this dock and future docks around the whole island or the whole project. As you can see, even that was a crazy turn, boat. We now have functional cargo docks. If you watched the live stream, we're having a ton of issues with that. Passenger docks were working totally fine. In fact, this ship right here will hopefully be able to achieve or reach the shoreline with success. But we're having a ton of issues with that. And I spent some time tweaking my custom-made cargo docks. And let me just show you what they look like. Then we're going to talk about these beautiful rocks. But let me go all the way to this side of the island. And I'm going to use Find It to look for DIY. So basically, I created this set. It's a pack, actually, that's called the DIY Concrete Dock, and basically comes in cargo flavors, passenger flavors, and ploppable flavors. So you can simply create your own dock and, you know, do something like this. Obviously, you can use Move It to, you know, move it. Let's bring this up, for example, bring this up. Obviously, they're complaining about roads and power. I'm not going to connect them, but you get the idea. I don't have to explain to you how this works. So now you have this concrete slab here that's ready to use. You can even, for example, add a crane. You like cranes? Well, you can just add a, you know, like a loading crane of some sort. Just put it here. It's too low. No problem. Grab, move it, bring it up. What else? You want construction or you want containers? I don't usually like containers, but you can just simply grab a few containers like this. These are really ugly, by the way. Not the containers, but my poor job of aligning things. There we go. I'm using Move It and prop snapping, if I'm not mistaken. So let's bring this up a bit like so. So now we have, you know, your own DIY dock. So these are in the asset workshop right now. You can download them. You only have to download once and you'll get the three packs. There's one caveat with the passenger, terminal, I guess, in this case. Cargo is perfect. It's ready to go. And ships will, like, get really close to the shoreline. However, for passengers, I tried, you know, multiple things to get it right. The only thing that I was able to do that actually solved this issue is using Move It and select everything, you know, nodes and segments for the most part. Just draw a rectangle around, you know, in front of the passenger terminal. And then use your arrow keys to move these nodes closer, basically where you want these ships to spawn. So now, as I move that, now ships will spawn much closer to the edge of the concrete slab instead of in the middle of the water. That's the only way I was able to get this to work. Once you save your game, it will remain there. But if you plop a new one, you'll have to do that again. So, you know, just something to keep in mind. But let me go back to the rocks real quick. We're going to get rid of this off camera. Don't worry. Someone will take care of that. So these rocks, if you remember in the, and I promise this is the last thing before we actually go into building things, but in the last episode, you might have remembered that I used the piles of rubble, basically, from natural disasters, so that I would have some sort of breakwater type effect. And it looked okay, but it wasn't really great. Unfortunately, those rocks don't really conform to the ground, so you were having a lot of floating rocks on the water, which is definitely not great. I decided to create my own rocks, and it's much, much harder than it seems. And these are sort of the best rocks I was able to put out so far. They're not in the workshop yet. They will be in the workshop soon, but it won't. It will probably take me a couple of weeks to get it right because there's a whole bunch of things that I wanted to do in order to release this asset and, you know, hopefully be useful for everyone. First of all, it doesn't have an LOD, so this is what the LOD looks like. You definitely don't want these in your city. But let me actually show you how they look and how they work. So get rid of the one-way arrows because they share the same shortcut. So, I mean, it doesn't even have an icon yet. But you can basically, it's a row of rocks at an angle. And this is like a specified angle. I tried actually having rocks that conform to the ground. They didn't look great. These ones look much, much better. Let me erase this using Move It so you can see what the model looks like. I also need to like get rid of some of these faces to like improve performance. Because if you go to the mesh, you'll see that it's 2,400 triangles, which is actually not bad. There are actual vehicles that have this many tries. And this obviously occupies, you know, a bit of a larger footprint. So having heavy polys in a belt like this is actually not a problem. However, I think I can improve it a little bit better. So, you know, the more optimization, so the faster the game you will run, and hopefully the more FPS you'll get. And a couple of things that I'm thinking for this once I actually release it is, well, first of all, I'm going to have a shorter version so you can, you know, so there's enough flexibility for corners and things like that. And I also want to add a version that has like a mossy texture that you can put along the water so that it looks like, you know, some of these rocks are actually wet. And in the case of our current breakwater over here, let me go back. I'm stacking multiple layers of them because of the angle. You know, it's when you have gentle angles like this, it's definitely harder to get things to align properly. So I might even release like a single row of rocks that you can basically put down in areas where you want, like, you know, really gentle slopes. And hopefully this will be like a really flexible type of pack that will allow you to, you know, use these types of rocks pretty much everywhere. But yeah, wow, that was quite a bit of talking. Let's actually go build some things, and then I'm going to talk about a few other things that I have here on my list. So we're starting off with a bit of maintenance on the road access to the docks. You see, the one in real life is actually really, really narrow, and I knew that from before by looking at reference photos. However, I just figured out that I could use, instead of a regular road, I could just use the pedestrian paths that are significantly narrower. And not only that, the actual road in real life, it's paved with like a tile kind of pattern. So I figured I could use this one and then use some decals on top of it to achieve a very, very similar look. Obviously when you zoom out and the decals, you know, because of the rendering distance, eventually vanish, you at least get to see a texture that kind of resembles the one that I'm going to be using when you zoom in. So I think it came out pretty nice. I also put down some lights. You're just going to see it in a moment. But before I continue describing what I'm doing on screen, there's a couple of shout outs that I want to give. First of all, I want to thank Lee Towers. Hopefully he's watching this video. I know he has left comments before, but he was a huge help putting together the docks, the dock assets. There was a conversation that he started on Simtropolis. He was trying to do a similar thing, building its own custom cargo harbor, and he can get the ships to dock closer to the shoreline, given that the vanilla ones are so long. That's why they behave the way they do. But using mod tools, there's a few little tricks that he was able to find to fine-tune things. So huge thanks to him. Also, I want to give a shout out to King Leno, who basically released the first gas station that we're going to be using later on in Seenu. It actually looks fantastic. I did showcase it a little bit during the live stream, but I'm also going to include the link in the description of this video if you want to try it out in your cities. It does look really, really cool, and we're obviously going to be using it in Seenu in future episodes, so stay tuned for that. Also, wanted to talk about Prop It Up, because it recently has been updated. So for those of you who have no idea about what I'm, you know, about this mod or what I'm talking about, so Prop It Up is a mod, I think by Judas, if I'm not mistaken, that hit the workshop about a week ago, and basically allows you to replace any props or trees with other props or trees. And it sounds amazing, it really does, but when it came out, there was like one tiny little thing that for me was a deal breaker, which was the fact that when you zoom out, the LODs for the original props would show. So let me give you an example. If you replace all of the vanilla oak trees with, I don't know, let's say a palm tree, when you zoom out, the palm trees will vanish and the LODs for the vanilla oaks will show, which to me, that was like a complete deal breaker. But I've been told that with the help of Bloody Penguin, he was able to get that fixed. So now you can use Prop It Up. In fact, there's that little tree icon on the bottom right corner is the mod. I'm replacing every single vanilla tree in this in the city, and I no longer have to use tree replacer, which was really, really buggy. In fact, I was having a few issues when I was trying to record this episode, so I was really relieved that now that it's a possibility and it's much more flexible and it works on the fly and it does have its own interface, so it's much more easier to use. I highly recommend it. I haven't tried, you know, removing other props, but I think it would work well for that as well. So if you have, for example, like me, you probably know by now that I hate the vanilla containers, like super colorful containers. If I'm not mistaken, you can use Prop It Up to change that. So something to keep in mind. Again, I'm gonna include that link in the description. Man, there's gonna be so many links in the description of this video. It's ridiculous. Let's see, what else? Okay. So a few things about Rico. So parts of the problem that I was having loading this save, and the reason why I really wanted to do a few more things for this episode, just so you know, I wanted to build a few more things, but I was just, it took me so long, first of all, to get the concrete docks to work properly, because I was having issues with mod tools. I mean, by now I think I know every single bug that could exist in Cities Skylines. That doesn't mean I can help you fix all the bugs. I do get emails all the time from people with random errors that, like, dude, I don't know, I have no idea how to fix that. I know where to start, I guess, to fix a few of these things, but mostly it's just trial and error and figuring things out. But what was I saying? Yes, so I spent some time trying to get the concrete docks to work. So that was like half of my week spent on doing that. The other half was, I lost like 48 hours just trying to get Seenu to run, like with nothing new, just like Seenu to run. Because I was loading the save game and I was getting all these crazy errors that were happening over and over again. And I realized that the issue was Rico, actually. You see, you probably remember this, but I said that I wanted to avoid using grow balls completely in the city. And I'm planning on doing that. But I realized that Rico, when you create your own buildings, where you add vanilla buildings to Rico, it's kind of buggy. It doesn't work quite well. By default, in fact, you need to just set it to the right category. It doesn't recognize that. For example, if you had an industrial building, you manually have to set it to industrial. Otherwise, it will just create a residential building that looks like a factory. But the main issue that I was having is the fact that I tried to add a few specialization, I can't even say that word, buildings, vanilla buildings, actually, to Rico. It turns out that there's some really amazing looking buildings in the forestry category, actually. Also, even in the ore mining category, too. But specifically with forestry, I've been told that there's a bug where the actual word forestry is misspelled in the code, which makes it crash, apparently. I've been told that AJ3D, who's the author of the mod, is actually issuing a patch soon. It might have been out by now, so I have to check that. But I'm still gonna try to go 100% Rico on this map. I know there are mods that allow you to treat grow walls as Rico without using Rico. And I do have at least two of those mods. Maybe I'm missing another one, but I do have the no abandonment mod, which basically forbids or prevents buildings from becoming abandoned, as well as the no zone check. But I mean, that way you can just grab, for example, an industrial building, plop it using Find It, for example, and you don't even have to zone underneath. It just like works. However, I did find issues with that, specifically with forestry buildings, because I realized, okay, I can do forestry with Rico, so I might as well get all these mods and plop grow walls. But it turns out you need the zone, like the district, to be forestry in order for that to work. So it's like, oh man, are you kidding me? I don't want to have to create districts at all. So that was an issue. I know these are like very specific problems that I'm having right now, but it's, I just couldn't use it. So I'm going to wait for Rico to be updated and hopefully try again to add all these vanilla buildings that are actually really, really nice. And you'll see them in future episodes, hopefully. Let me quickly go back to what I'm doing here in the time lapse, because I haven't been talking about the progress that's being made right now. So In this area of the map, in real life, it appears to be like an open air kind of landfill situation going on. And I decided to extend it a little bit beyond that asset that we have, that base asset that we have. And also I'm pairing it with the incinerator plant, which not only will burn most of the garbage from the city, but it also provide power to the island as well. And right next to that, I also noticed that there was a bit of, you know, piles of sand that I think are being dredged from the bottom of the ocean and put on this area of the map, or dumped on this area of the map from coming from ships. And those are eventually put on trucks to, like, you know, basically fill different areas of the islands, or to make embankments or things like that. So I thought it was actually a perfect spot for that. And you're going to see me add a lot of construction equipment in just a moment. A ton of decals, like a crazy amount of decals, are really what makes this whole thing come together. But I think the combination of me terraforming the land and using that cliff texture that looks like sand, together with the sand piles, I think those are from Avania, if I'm not mistaken, even though it looks a little bit glitchy, which I've never seen that before. But they do look kind of amazing, and you have like this different shades of sand textures that really work very well together. So that's something rather interesting that's going on there. Again, I'm just filling this whole area with tons of props. I grab a whole bunch of tires, and using that flux technique for getting the grass to look much more realistic, basically creating a cluster and then duplicating it using Move It, it's really the way to go. So I was able to create some really realistic tire setups. And later on, you're going to see me add just like one tiny touch of fire to some of those tires, which, like, I don't know. I thought it was pretty amazing how it came out. You're probably going to see it in the cinematics. I actually don't know if I left it in a clip, but trust me, it's worth taking a look at. Now, I want to change subject slightly and wanted to sort of mention something rather interesting that happened recently. So for those of you who know Yuto, he's another YouTuber. I've done collaborations with him a long time ago. In fact, recently I created a burnt, destroyed version of Cedar Valley. And this was before natural disasters, mind you, for his Astrogia series. But the last episode of that series, I'm going to include the link also in the description, he interviewed a cedar planter, and there's actually a couple of really interesting topics that they talk about, specifically about walkability in cities. So if you're interested in learning more on how to make better urban planning in your own cities, or, you know, if you're planning on doing that for a career, I highly encourage you to check that out. It's really fun. Also, Yuto's projects are really, really interesting. He covers so many topics while he builds things, so I highly recommend that as well. But finally here, we're approaching at the end of the time lapse. I'm adding you know, foliage and vegetation around the different areas. And you probably noticed that I removed some of the walkable paths and started replacing them with a surface painter path that look much, much better. And there you go. That's the fire that I was telling you about just a second ago. Don't worry. You're going to be able to see that in greater detail during the cinematics that are just starting in a few seconds as we approach the end of this time lapse. But not before I do some road markings here and there, just, you know, completing this neighborhood altogether, making it all look much, much nicer. I'm sure we'll have to come back to some of these areas, specifically the ones around the breakwater rocks, because, well, once I redo them, I might have to replace them. That's unfortunately what's probably going to happen. But yeah, I'm running out of time for this episode. So if you enjoyed, please consider giving this video a like. It helps a lot. And if you're new to the channel, I highly encourage you to go click the subscribe button right next to the bell icon. That way you're notified immediately after one of my videos comes out. There's a link in the description to the full playlist in case you might have missed an episode. And if you want to stay up to date with, you know, the future of the channel, getting teasers before everyone else, you should follow me on Twitter, twitter.com/strictdoster. But that's it. That's all that I have to say for now. Thank you for watching, and hope to see you in the next one.